And welcome to this edition of CBN News Focus. I'm Ephraim Graham. Voters are giving the president a few lumps of coal this Christmas. The latest numbers show his approval rating is the ugliest since the Nixon administration. A new Washington Post ABC News poll has 55% of Americans disapproving of his job performance. And the botched health care rollout is the leading reason he's losing favor with some of his biggest supporters. Just a year into his second term, there is no shortage of opinions on the president's job performance.
His heart's in the right place, but just not good enough.
He needs to just step out there and be more forceful and get the things done.
No president has been the perfect president. Every president has messed up at some point in time.
Younger voters were among the president's strongest supporters. Many campaigned hard to get him elected in 2008 and re-elected in 2012. A year later, polls suggest a growing number are suffering from buyer's remorse. When USA Today and the Pew Research Center polled millennials early in 2013, 67% approved of the president's job performance. In that same poll now, just 45% approve.
He's still going to be seen by them as the coolest president ever so far. But they also think of cool as you got to be competent too, and they don't see him that way.
I think his heart's in the right place.
Kendall Crawford is one of those young voters who cast her ballot for Obama in 2008 and 2012. Today, she has a list of disappointments. At the very top, the faltering health care reform.
In health care, I feel like he could have put a bit more, I guess, maybe just appointed someone and made sure that they got it straight, since it was such an important issue, especially throughout his first term.
Healthcare is the president's signature legislation, and young voters' lack of confidence in it could spell trouble for its future.
Those people were expected to sign up to pay for it. You know, in other words, the young people had to be brought in. They were the ones who would pay for this. And so they're not doing that. They're afraid like everybody else is.
Obamacare, it's not, I see what he wants to do, but it's not going along well.
For now, time may be on the side of Republicans who are looking to take control of the Senate.
I think that the implosion of Obamacare and the response of the administration is enough to damage big government without Republicans making a big show of saying, we killed the president's signature law. I don't think they need to do that as much as they need to let it die, and then they offer the options people like.
From health care to the IRS Tea Party scandal to the backlash over NSA record collecting, The Washington Post declared President Obama as having the worst year in Washington. Political blogger Chris Saliza wrote, when historians write the story of Barack Obama's presidency, 2013 will be his lost year. It opened with great promise and closed with equally great disappointment. With the shift now in support from young voters, all eyes are on 2014 elections to see what the impact will be. The latest poll also shows more Americans now trust Republicans more when it comes to handling the economy. On January 1st, the European Union could punish a Middle East country with economic sanctions. No, it is not over nuclear Iran's weapons program. The EU's target is Israel. Chris Mitchell reports now from Brussels, Belgium.
New economic guidelines would prohibit money from the EU to Israeli communities beyond what's called the Green Line, also known as the West Bank. In order to receive funding, private Israeli entities must prove they have no ties to the West Bank, the Golan Heights, and East Jerusalem. The economic impact could run into the millions. Some believe the move is part of a growing anti-Semitism moving across Europe. Those new EU guidelines are being established here in Brussels, Belgium, at the European Parliament. They represent a major economic challenge to Israel and could predetermine the borders of a future Palestinian state.
And these guidelines that basically restrict any type of cooperation, financial cooperation between Europe and these disputed territories. And it's more complicated than you would think, because even if you would have one particular university wanting to engage in a multi-million program with the EU, if you happen to have one professor living, say, in East Jerusalem, it would be impossible with these new guidelines.
Andrew Tucker of Christians for Israel International says the guidelines put Europe in the position of creating a Jew-free state.
But I think the thing that concerns us most is the signal that it's giving. And we're concerned that Europe is on a slippery slope towards enforcing the creation of a Palestinian state, and it will be a Palestinian state where Jews will not be welcome.
Tucker and others feel this slippery slope would pressure Israel to create a future Palestinian state based on the so-called 1967 borders, divide Jerusalem, and make it illegal for Jews to live there.
There's nothing in the guidelines to say that Jews are not allowed to live in a new Palestinian state, but we would see it as part of a broader project whereby Europe is saying all Israeli settlements are illegal, which means any Jew living in so-called Eastern Jerusalem, and you know better than I do, you know, this is the heart of Jewish Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria, is illegal. Once you buy into that, then it's a question of taking, implementing administrative steps to make it a reality, and the guidelines is just one example. Mm-hmm.
Israel and the EU did sign an economic agreement recently called Horizon 2020, but the financial restrictions remain in place for the disputed territories. Israel's representative to the EU feels that hurts both Israelis and Palestinians.
At the end of the day, if we are talking about the territories behind the 67 borders, it means also that settlements, but also Palestinians living around these settlements, are not going to benefit from these grants.
It reminds Sandel of the anti-Semitism spawned in Europe during the 1930s.
For me, this is anti-Semitism 2.0. It's more sophisticated, but it's very effective in terms of demonizing Jews, demonizing the Jewish state, and making life very difficult for those in particular who would want to live in these disputed territories. I know many people will be upset by hearing me stating this, but I do see similarities. Then they simply said, don't buy from Jews. Today is boycott Israel.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, the European Parliament, Brussels, Belgium.
Coming up, radical Islam in the Middle East, how the now banned Muslim Brotherhood is still working in Egypt. After Egypt officially banned the Muslim Brotherhood earlier this year, many people started dismissing the group, saying it was no longer a powerful arm of radical Islam. But as Eric Stackelbeck reports, the Brotherhood and the global movement it leads are far from over.
Dozens of Christian churches burned to the ground. Deadly attacks against Egyptian troops and police. Calls for jihad against the so-called enemies of Allah. That's just some of what the Muslim Brotherhood and its allies have been up to since the Egyptian military forced President Mohamed Morsi from office. The Brotherhood is clearly on the ropes in Egypt. It has once again been outlawed, and most of its leaders now sit in prison awaiting trial. Polls show that a large majority of Egyptians are pleased with the change. Millions of Egyptians consistently took to the streets in massive protest calling for Morsi's ouster.
People on the ground in Egypt are kind of sick of them.
Middle East expert and CBN contributor Raymond Ibrahim says Egyptian outrage is rooted in Morsi and the Brotherhood's decision to put the advancement of radical Islamist ideology over the good of the Egyptian people.
They're being accused of being disloyal, working with foreign entities, and just to get themselves in power and then to do their bidding.
The Brotherhood has also faced backlash in Tunisia, where it rose to power in 2011. Its Palestinian branch, Hamas, has been weakened as well. And a recent leadership change in the tiny oil-rich nation of Qatar, one of the Global Brotherhood's biggest financiers, may affect the group's efforts around the world. But don't begin writing an obituary just yet, because the Muslim Brotherhood remains active in some 70 countries worldwide, and it is resilient.
We have to remember that the Muslim Brotherhood is a very substantial factor in the Arab world. This is the biggest mass movement in the Arab Muslim Sunni world.
Avi Melamed is a former Israeli intelligence official. He says that as the Brotherhood struggles to regain its footing, even more radical forces like Al-Qaeda are seeking to take advantage in places like Syria.
Syria also become the stage for the struggle between practical political Syrian elements like the Free Syrian Army on the one hand, and radical Islam affiliated group who basically sees Syria as a great opportunity to establish an Al-Qaeda-style base in the heart of the Arab world.
The growing strength of Al-Qaeda and its allies became clear most recently in Kenya, where the terror group Al-Shabaab killed at least 67 people at a Nairobi shopping mall. At the same time, Shiite Iran continues its march towards a nuclear bomb, and its proxy Hezbollah has stockpiled tens of thousands of rockets and missiles. Then there is the Brotherhood-aligned Turkish government, which continues to be a powerful player in the Middle East and beyond.
As for the Muslim Brotherhood, CBN News has reported how its followers hold influential advisory positions in the Obama administration, and Muslim Brothers continue to lead violent protests against the interim Egyptian government.
Fact of anything, usually before a death blow, things get very chaotic and hectic and violent. So if anything, you can expect to see more of an outlash from the Brotherhood.
Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News, Washington.
Up next, what could be a dangerous habit for women? Is there a connection between cell phones and breast cancer? That question is coming up. It is a scary question. Can your cell phone give you cancer? And the answer for some women could be yes. As Lori Johnson reports, it depends on where they carry their cell phones.
Millions of women, especially young ones, choose to keep their cell phone in their bra.
It's convenience is the main thing. I mean, it's right here, so I don't have to wear a purse, or like if I have a dress on that's straight up and down, I don't have pockets.
A recent survey reveals 40% of college females make that choice at least sometime during the day, and 3% for more than 10 hours a day.
We must make the bra a no-phone zone.
Dr. John West believes storing the cell phone next to the breast for an extended time could cause breast cancer. But since cell phone technology is fairly new, evidence from critical long-term studies simply isn't available yet.
We won't know if in the next 20 or 30 years, we won't have collected sufficient number of cases to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that the cell phones are causing the cancer.
West says one clear signal is that he's seeing more breast cancer in young women than he's ever seen in his 40 years of practice.
When you take something that and put it directly on the skin, it's high energy microwave radiation for a prolonged period of time. In young women with vulnerable developing breasts, we may have a perfect storm.
Doctors diagnosed Donna Janes with breast cancer at just 38 years old.
I had to go through a mastectomy, a single mastectomy, went through chemo, 6 rounds of chemo, 39 doses of radiation. It was just back to back continuously. It was took a heavy toll.
Donna questioned how she got her cancer since she had no risk factors. The answer, she says, was on her X-ray.
I used to tuck my cell phone into my bra right in this area here. And when I was diagnosed, I had imaging done, and the doctors told me that the tumors were in the area of 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock. And they were shaped like the cell phone.
Donna stored her cell phone in her bra for about 10 years, but not anymore. Rachel DePalma shares an almost identical story.
Well, I used to wear it over the left side, and I would just tuck it in my bra whenever I would go for hikes and walks with my girlfriends.
That went on for about 5 years.
I just happened to be putting on a shirt, and I noticed the lump, and I thought, well, that's a little odd. That I don't remember that being there.
Stunned by her X-ray, Rachel came to what she calls an obvious conclusion.
The area where the cancer was found, the box that the radiologist drew just happened to be the same size as my BlackBerry phone.
Despite stories like these, women carrying cell phones in their bras is, if anything, becoming even more popular. In fact, many bras like this one are now on the market with pockets for cell phones.
Radiologist June Chen grew suspicious as she diagnosed more and more of her young patients with cancer.
It's very unusual for young women in their 20s and 30s to have breast cancer, period, yet alone such extensive breast cancers. And these women are vehemently telling us that they wore their cell phones over the area, directly over the area where they subsequently developed this extensive breast cancer. And they're telling us that they wore these cell phones there on a routine and regular basis.
She advises all women to keep their cell phones away from their bodies until studies conclude whether close proximity causes cancer.
I do think that there may be an association And therefore, since we're not sure, let's be cautious.
Most cell phone companies acknowledge some risk. For example, Apple advises keeping the iPhone more than half an inch from the body. But such safety guidelines are often overlooked.
The cell phone companies, they all now say, keep the cell phone away from the skin, but none of them deal with the issue. It's in the back of the manual, page 99, in small print. We need to get this to the surface.
So according to some breast cancer survivors and the doctors who treat them, women should declare the bra a no-phone zone before it's too late. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
Still to come, a chance to sit down, sip tea, and have a level-headed discussion about one of the most explosive topics of our time. That story when we come back. The debate over same-sex marriage is often framed as a culture war, but some people are trying a different approach, a civil discussion of the issues. A church recently sponsored a conversation on marriage in St. Louis, where both sides listened to what the other had to say. Heather Sells has that story.
Most of us are all too familiar with the battle over marriage.
Homophobia's got to go.
It's grown full of angry activists, soundbite slogans, and seemingly no common ground. That's why one church rented a nightclub in downtown St. Louis and invited both sides for an evening of calm discussion over the red-hot topic. Taking center stage, gay philosopher John Corvino and Christian philosopher Matthew Lee Anderson.
What's happening here in St. Louis breaks new ground in that it provides a different way to talk about one of the most divisive issues of our day. In fact, the event is billed not as a debate, but as a reasonable conversation.
So much of the marriage debate that we see in public on stage does involve the sound bites, the zingers, the how do I slam this guy? And get everybody to cheer and yell and laugh and clap. And we want to do something different.
A non-denominational evangelical church, The Journey, organized the evening. It drew a younger crowd with a wide range of beliefs, but all hoping for a deep exploration of the issue.
We're really honestly just wondering what both sides have to say. I'm happy that it's even happening in general, that it's something that people are talking about.
I think people should support homosexuality and gay marriage and all those things. And I find it interesting that people are so against it, just, you know, from a religious standpoint.
As the evening progressed, it became clear that Corvino and Anderson, while calmly sipping tea, would not shy away from speaking to the hardest points, like this on equality.
Conceptions like fairness and equality are massively disputed here.
Sure.
The LGBT movement has done a very good job of branding itself and claiming equality. And I think there's just a fundamental disagreement over what the conditions of equality are.
And the value of marriage for gays.
Relationships are good for people. And marriage is good for relationships. Marriage is a way of recognizing people as the family unit they understand themselves to be.
Also addressed harassment of gays and intolerance for Christians.
So it may be the case that in many rural communities and suburban communities, LGBT people experience severe hostility and repression. And that's unfortunate. But it is also the case that if you get into an elite context in the academy, in Hollywood, in New York, in some of these places, there are genuine social costs that people with conservative positions on human sexuality pay.
What seemed to make the evening work, Corvino and Anderson's willingness to engage on all questions while showing humor along the way.
I'm interested in a Christianity that thinks not only about our current situation, but that thinks 500 years down the road. And if we...
That's a lot to have on your mind.
It's a lot to have on your mind, but I think it's actually a responsible thing to do, to think multi-generationally about this.
In the end, no one converted to the other side, but those we spoke with felt better informed and grateful that neither side turned on the other.
I think it's good that there's a dialogue going on, that, you know, it's not a us versus them.
It's natural to disagree. That's just human nature. But to be able to be, you know, poignant, but at the same time, like, not offensive and just open about that dialogue, I thought was awesome.
I come from a Christian background, and so getting to hear both sides and getting to especially hear John coming from an atheistic view and getting to hear his perspective was really enlightening.
As the church seeks to find its voice in a culture that frequently dismisses biblical views, such forums could pave the way. Author and speaker Eric Metaxas says believers must explore a variety of approaches. The key, he says, showing boldness, humility, and love.
If your heart does not break for somebody struggling with same-sex attraction, you have no business talking to them or even about them. We're called to love people, right? And so if people don't see that love, how are they not going to tune us out?
If it's up to Corvino and Anderson, they'll take this show on the road. A small step, perhaps, but one that could lead the way for addressing an issue that affects us all. Reporting in St. Louis, Heather Sells, CBN News.
And that is all for this hour of the CBN News Channel. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. And stay up to date with CBN News through Facebook and Twitter. We hope you'll join us again right here next time. Have a great day and a wonderful weekend.